uterine artery will be tackled better first. We can go for uterine and then we can go for the other dissection. Then for vaginal morcellation of big uterus, we can use number 22 blade instead of number 1, which is with our hands. Then we can go for intra-abdominal morcellation with scissors, or with, there are scalpels also available, or monopolar hook we can use. This we can do, either we can just chop off the uterus into halves and keep the cervix for guidance, and after we remove from vagina, we can have the other side of the uterus, we can hold it with ellipse and we can remove one part. So this is also a good method. The other, we know, all of us know that we can use morcellator, in-bag morcellation, all these are the other methods. While removing uterus, one more tip I want to share here, that always remove the Foley's catheter, because the bulb, which it can cause injury to the bladder vessels and bladder capillaries, and it can cause avulsion to bladder also. Then myoma screw is always better than vaginal manipulation because of the weight factor of the uterus in case of large uteri. Then one more tip I want to share, that use of tenaculum at the cervix while we go around the cervix while removing the vaginal cuff, because the force with which we lift the uterus with myoma, sometimes the myoma may slip off and it may injure other structures. So better to use tenaculum for separation of the cervix. And that's it, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vaisha. You are doing so much of work at this age. But I would, I'm a little skeptical about your, that Foley's catheter should not be kept during TLH. It should be removed, because may reduce the amount of fluid into it, but I don't think you should remove it completely.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. We can deflate the bulb if we are already catheterized, or we can remove it for a short while and afterwards we can again put the catheter.
And the vaginal manipulator also may not help in the upper part, but while doing colpotomy, it is a great help. And I think most of us are using vaginal manipulation also. Thank you, Dr. Sushila, for the session, for helping me chair this. I think you
thank
can
you, thank you, Dr. Dinesh, ma'am.
Thank you, Sushila, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you all the speakers of the session, Dr. Dimpak Limbachia sir, Dr. Meenakshi Goyal, Dr. Pandit Palashkar sir. Everybody presented so well and clear all the doubts about the hysterectomy, and I think now all the delegates, hysterectomy will know for any hard task. And as Dr. Dimpak Limbachia say, radical is more easier than the simpler one. So we will follow the steps and try to make that kind of the surgery. So we now move to the next session. The next session is pelvic organ prolapse surgeries, and actually it is also a common problem in India, and around 40-50% women after age of the 40-50, they had the genital organ prolapse, and we have to know how to manage this problem. There may be the general consignment that everybody has to take it out, but there is other options that we can fix the uterus back, and we can actually do something for the young prolapse patients. So for the chair the session, the next I would like to invite Dr. Vijay Natha sir, consultant and head of the department in the Mahatma Gandhi Medical College endoscopy department, and is actually a patron of our society also. So over to Dr. Vijay Natha sir.
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. Very good work going on, and so many people are connected with us. So this is a section on prolapse, and our first speaker is none other than Dr. B. Ramesh, and he is the MD of the Elitus Hospital, Bangalore. He is the chairperson of endoscopy committee of FOCSI. He has performed more than 70,000 major surgeries. And he's past president of Bangalore OB Society, and he's a pioneer of the single port surgeries. He has authored 3 books, and the list of awards is the full page, the Aryabhatt, Kannad, Rajaswa, many, many lists, big list. And one more very interesting thing I came to know, that he has donated a school building and he's a promoter of cycling also. So welcome, sir. Birame sir, please, podium is yours. Hello, Birame sir.
Sir, please unmute yourself. Sir, we cannot hear you. Sir, we Ramesh sir, we cannot hear you. Hello. Sir, was is sir not there?
Sir is there. But its video is not on.
So please start sharing your screen.
I'm just making a call.
Sir is not picking the phone also. Sir is not answering actually. Why? I don't know where he is.
So, can we take Manish or?
Sir is there. Sir is there. सर आवाज आपकी नहीं आ रही है बीरमे सर
यस
यस सर यस सर सर नाउ वी कैन सी योर प्रेजेंटेशन सर वी आर एबल टू सी योर प्रेजेंटेशन
Please make it in slide mode, sir.
Sir, click it from the top corner. Slideshow from here. Sir is not able to connect. Sir, you can share your screen. Sir, aapka awaaz nahi aa raha hai. Sir, we cannot hear you. Sir, pick up the phone. Hello. Sir, I have unmuted you and you are not on mute. Sir, but yahan se to sir aapka on hai. Your voice is not coming. Now, sir, again unmute yourself. So now check, please. I have unmuted here. We have
Can you hear now?
Now, can you hear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now
we can hear you. Okay. What is it? The microphone, sir. Select
Start sharing your screen, sir. Yeah. Okay. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
It's already sharing.
PowerPoint, sir.
It's already.
Sorry for the delay. So congratulations, Sushila, for this excellent sort of workshop. It is as good as attending a live workshop. It's a wonderful,
yes,
it is a wonderful piece of work. And of course, we are going to have debate, which is better, pectopexy or sacrocolpopexy. The same old thing what we did in New Delhi sometime back. So now, the laparoscopic management of the prolapse, any prolapse. I think the principles behind with uterus or the post-hysterectomy vault prolapse are similar. So in a young patient with a uterus intact, so what we do is we fix the mesh to the cervix and to the sacral promontory. Whereas post-hysterectomy, it is little bit complicated. The dissection involves more of dissection. So in post-hysterectomy vault prolapse, the aims of the surgery is to relieve the symptom, to restore the anatomy, to restore the function, that is very important, and to prevent the recurrence in future. And sacrocolpopexy is the most suitable surgery for post-hysterectomy prolapse, vault prolapse, because it is most anatomical and physiological correction. Vaginal length is maintained, especially for young patients who have prolapse, the vaginal length is maintained and vaginal axis is maintained and even the recurrence will be less. And sacrocolpopexy is the strongest and most durable correction for vault prolapse till date. So indication most suitable for young and active patients. So we always feel these kind of surgeries are better for older patients. No, they are good for young and active patient. And if there is a recurrent vault prolapse, if you have already done some procedure like Purandare or Kanna or something like that, so definitely sacrocolpopexy or sacrohysteropexy is an excellent procedure. Patient with connective tissue weakness and multiple hernias, so sacrocolpopexy is a good procedure. So patient with chronic increase in intra-abdominal pressure who are likely to develop prolapse, so the chronic bronchitis, asthma, chronic constipation, all these patients are benefited. So anatomic support and in meta-analysis, 30 trials concluded that sacrocolpopexy had superior outcome compared with variety of vaginal procedures, including sacrospinous, uterospinous ligament, and transvaginal mesh. So sacrocolpopexy is more appropriate for women with risk factor for prolapse recurrence, including obesity and fourth degree prolapse, third and fourth degree, prone to high impact activities or heavy lifting or previous failed prolapse repair. Other indication is insufficient vaginal length for transvaginal repair, especially those who have gone vaginal excision during prolapse surgery. And so now you can see this is the young vault prolapse post hysterectomy. So you can see the whole vault is coming out. So, and if you repair this vaginally, the results will not be so satisfactory. So normally what we put is the CCL extractor or a vaginal tube. So what we use for the hysterectomy vaginal tube, the smaller size is good enough to elevate the vault. Unless you elevate the vault, the dissection is going to be difficult. So you start as high as possible with peritoneum. So because many times the bladder is advanced, one has to be careful. very to avoid the injury to the bladder and rectum. Both bladder and rectum are at risk in this surgery. So identify the proper plane with sharp dissection. Don't go too much laterally also. There is always a plane, and that is the posterior dissection. So posterior dissection, definitely how much you dissect depends upon your personal this thing. So normally we dissect into the rectovaginal space and up to the levator ani, so that the mesh can be fixed to the levator ani. And even if the patient has descending perineum syndrome, so the mesh is fixed to the levator ani, and the descending perineum syndrome, the levator is lifted up and descending perineum syndrome will disappear. And you can see here the scissor or harmonic are the best instrument. It is said at least half of the length of the vagina should be, if you are a beginner and if you are not able to dissect the entire length of the vagina, it is not necessary to dissect the entire, it is better to dissect the entire length of the vagina. But for safety sake, and if you are a beginner, it is okay to dissect at least half or 3/4 of the anterior vaginal wall. So one, and you cannot go below the dome of the trigone of the bladder. And once you dissect, you take a soft prolapse. What is shown is the hernia mesh. Don't do with the hernia mesh. Never do with the hernia mesh. So you should always go with the soft polypropylene mesh, which is a good material and which produces less fibrosis and less inflammation. And you must always use non-absorbable suture like Ethibond or Proline. Don't use absorbable suture. Otherwise, the mesh can get detached from the vault and there could be recurrence of the prolapse, vault prolapse. So the mesh has to be anchored properly. Don't go too much laterally also. There is no need because the ureter is closed laterally, and you can see here the once the mesh is fixed, and on that the bladder can be covered. So once the anterior mesh is fixed, so we take a separate mesh, say around 3 into 10 cm or 3 into 12 cm is the ideal length. So the posterior mesh is fixed to the posterior vaginal wall and again fixed with the non-absorbable suture here. So if you are a really advanced surgeon, you can go up to the levator ani muscle and split the mesh, and one arm of the mesh goes to the each levator ani on both the sides, so that the V of the mesh sits in the on the levator ani muscle and in between the rectum. So once both the meshes are fixed to the vaginal side, the peritoneal closure starts. And you can incorporate the uterosacral ligament into the suturing, so that the uterosacral ligament also acts as a support to the vault. All of us know that uterosacral ligament, and in particularly in this patient, you can see that the uterosacral is strong enough so that you can incorporate the uterosacral ligament for the support to the vault and the mesh. And now the peritoneum is closed. And you need not have to take the deep vaginal wall here. So because we have already taken the the vagina, fix the mesh into the vagina. And about the tacker, normally we don't use tacker nowadays because it produces a lot of clinical problems. So it is better to use the simple stitch like this. Even one or two non-absorbable suture will save the cost also. Tacker is costly also. And once you open, it is very difficult to sterilize for further. So nicely you can see the anterior longitudinal ligament, and the mesh should be fixed without tension. The mesh should be fixed without tension. It should be just the approximation between the vagina and the sacral promontory. A non-absorbable suture. And you can see here the peritoneum is closed. The mesh should be retroperitonized always. Otherwise, the mesh attracts a lot of adhesion. A well-performed sacrocolpopexy gives an excellent result, but at the same time, it is equally dangerous if you are not well-versed with the anatomy of the retroperitoneum. So efficacy of laparoscopic cervicopexy for apical support, sacrocervicopexy is an effective technique in the treatment of severe pelvic organ prolapse. The advantage include low recurrence rate, absence of mesh erosion, because we are doing the entire thing laparoscopically, the mesh erosion chances are less, preserving an adequate vaginal length and maintaining the proper physiological vaginal axis. So in pectopexy, what happens is the uterus and the vault is pushed anteriorly or laterally. So the axis of the vagina is towards the sacral promontory. So probably sacropexy is the only surgery which maintains the axis, the physiological axis towards the sacral promontory. And there are many studies to prove that sacral colpopexy is a good. In the conclusion, laparoscopic, this study shows that colpopexy is feasible and highly effective technique that offers good long-term results with complication rate similar to those in open surgery, with added benefit of being minimally invasive. The complications are similar to other surgeries, and sacrocolpopexy is considered the gold standard procedure. So I can say it is the gold standard procedure for the surgical correction of the vaginal vault prolapse. Of course, with uterus, there are so many procedures, but after post-hysterectomy vault prolapse, based on numerous level one studies reporting its efficacy and long-term durability. Long-term durability is also very important because we do this in many young patients. And this study says a mean follow-up 6 months, 96% of the symptomatic women had successful vaginal vault support with no recurrence, and successful anatomical report was found in almost 90%. And stress urinary incontinence resolved in 67% without concomitant continence surgery, though it can produce incontinence in 16%, but this study says, so the incontinence got cured in 67% of the thing. So the operation is successful in supporting the vaginal vault in 9 out of 10 cases. Success rate over 3 to 5 years is 9%. 90%. No success rate are yet available for longer than this. Now it is almost 10 years success rate, say close to 90%. And so these are all the advantages, and 83% or even more than that of the woman got satisfied. And of course, is associated with significant lower dyspareunia, post-operative SUI, and higher level satisfaction. And patient generally had high satisfaction and low regret for regarding surgical correction of sacrocolpopexy. And pextopexy is a promising method. I think that is the Sushila's favorite method, but I will tell you it is a good and simple method, but that has its own drawbacks. It is especially helpful in cases of difficult cases of sacrocolpopexy. Suppose if the patient has undergone multiple abdominal surgery or fibrosis at the sacral promontory level or in the pelvis, where sacrocolpopexy is a difficult one, definitely pectopexy is a definite alternative for laparoscopic sacral colpopexy. Pectopexy is a very good alternative in these kind of cases. So again, these are all the studies, trial colpopexy. So see the follow-up up to 6 months, they say it is very good. And so lower risk and awareness of prolapse, recurrence of prolapse, repeat surgery, the limit does not support. So mesh, transvaginal mesh is a very messy thing. So you should never do transvaginal mesh repair for any prolapse. It is always laparoscopic prolapse. So the pectopexy drawbacks, vaginal axis is changed. It is not the natural axis. Increased incidence of enteroceles, because to a certain extent it pulls the vaginal axis and the uterus little bit anteriorly or laterally. There is a possibility of enterocele, and recurrence of prolapse is slightly higher than the sacrocolpopexy, because in sacrocolpopexy we are fixing the mesh to the very strong structure, that is the anterior longitudinal ligament of the vertebra. And again, this is the laparoscopic pectopexy cannot be generally recommended as an alternative to sacrocolpopexy. It is not an alternative to colpopexy, because sacropexy is a gold standard for any prolapse, especially in young patient. But if there is any difficulty or adhesions or high risk patient, pectopexy is an alternative. The new method can be considered where bears a higher risk of injury to the pelvic organs or anything, then the pectopexy can be considered. De novo stress urinary incontinence, urgency, defecation problems, as well as perioperative complications were not statistically significant between different pectopexy and sacropexy. That means an expert doing either pectopexy or sacrocolpopexy, most of the complications are similar. So of course, no disadvantages, a comprehensive review, anatomic success rate is almost around 90%, and satisfaction rate and complete relief of symptoms in almost 85 to 100%. 5% less recurrence chance may be because of the patient may be having chronic cough or constipation or weak tissues, etc. And less post-operative dyspareunia because the correction is done well and time-tested. So now sacrocolpopexy is a time-tested method, and almost it is there for many years. Earlier it was abdominal sacrocolpopexy, now it is laparoscopic colpopexy, and we have enough of RCTs and meta-analysis to prove that sacropexy is the gold standard for the prolapse, and it can be performed by all the gynecologists. And goal of the medicine is not to prolong life, but to improve the quality of life. So definitely sacrocolpopexy is one of the surgery which improves the quality of life of an younger woman who has got a prolapse, both with the uterus and without the uterus. And thank you very much, Sushila, for giving this opportunity.
Sir, Ramesh sir, it was a fantastic lecture. I invite the next speaker. Sir, Ramesh sir, please remain with us, because a lot many questions are there and that debate is there. So I invite the next speaker, none other than queen of the day, that is Dr. Sushila Seni. She is organizer of this Raj Endogyny, and this sixth consecutive we are having because of the COVID virtual. And I will just say and wish that she is our next IAG president. And she is always smiling. And now because COVID, always there is a mask. So she has developed a technique of smiling with the eyes. His eyes are always glimmering and smiling. So Dr. Sushila, all the podium is yours, please.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. And I will not waste more of the time. Dr. Ramesh, please stop sharing your screen. And actually, Dr. Ramesh already said that there is a debate between the sacropexy and pectopexy, but we are not doing any debate here. There is two methods for correcting the prolapse, like sacropexy, pectopexy, lateral uterine suspension, and many other sling methods also there. So, pectopexy is a little close to my heart. And sir, please stop sharing your screen.
Yeah.
Pectopexy is just a little bit close to my heart. And just I want to share a little few things how I start actually the pectopexy. I am doing also the sacropexy, which is the gold standard thing. Everybody, I am so learned everything from you and all the senior gynecologists of the India and that. But one of my cases failed after sacropexy. Then I am looking for the another technique. How now can give the result? Because patient come back to me and I have done the sacropexy and sacropexy is failed. Then I'm looking for another technique. Then I started with the lateral uterine suspension, that is the sling from the lateral parts and through the broad ligament and fixing the mesh over the cervix. Then also in the one case of the lateral uterine suspension, there is a mesh infection because we are introducing the mesh through the skin. And then also, then I am looking for another new technique, what we can do now. So the pectopexy is the actually came in the scene, and I started doing the pectopexy, and what I found is that when I am doing the sacropexy in the my patient, there was a little few problems associated with the sacropexy. I don't know, it was my early beginner career maybe responsible for that, or there is a technique difference what I was following. There was a defecation problem, constipation problem, and there is de novo SUI problem also. And most important is the backache. Sacropexy patient always complain backache. Some don't know why they are complaining, but what I believe that we are dissecting over the sacral promontory, we are putting the suture and we are putting the tecus over the sacral promontory, that may be a cause of the backache. And I started the pectopexy seeing on the YouTube videos and following the new Zettel and everyone videos. And what I found, the patient is very much comfortable after pectopexy. They are not complaining anything about backache, not complaining any SUI, not complaining any constipation problem. So many benefit I have seen. And since last 2 years, I am following this technique. So I am just going first for the video only directly. So we are performing last 2 years, and till now we have performed around 120 cases, and there is no apical failure yet. Yes, one or two, there is a cystocele and rectocele was there. So I don't think there is lots of the failure of this technique. Pectopexy is little easier, what I find easier than the sacropexy. And we start with lifting the UV fold and separating the bladder. You just separate the bladder as we are dissecting in the TLH or in any other case. Then extend this UV fold incision parallel to the round ligament till the lateral pelvic wall, and this external iliac vein is there, and just below this vein the fat tissue is there, and we have to just dissect bluntly and sharply below this vein. So there is a chances to injury this vein, so we have to very much careful here. And this whitish shining structure is pectineal ligament, and pectineal ligament is a very strong structure, and we can actually, when putting the suture, and we can move the patient, shake the patient after putting the suture bilaterally in the this Pupus ligament or pectineal ligament. So we dissect pectineal ligament on both the side, and what is the actually the landmark of dissecting this dissecting this pectineal ligament. Just a video is actually postponed. So what landmark is the just parallel to the anterior of this round ligament and below the external iliac vein and medial to this obliterated umbilical artery. This is the obliterated umbilical artery, and we are just dissecting medial to this obliterated umbilical artery below the external iliac vein. And on the anteriorly there is a corona mortis, which Dr. Kuntambikar showed very well in the morning. So after dissection of bilaterally pectineal ligament, both the side, and dissecting the bladder enough down to take care of the cystocele also, then we insert this mesh. The mesh is designed like a 15 centimeter long mesh, and there is a 4 to 6 centimeter according to the length which we want to put on the anterior vaginal wall. We can just tailor the mesh or design the mesh, and fixing the mesh with ethibond suture, taking the full good bite in the vaginal wall and cervix. So we are not disturbing at all in the posterior compartment. So we are putting 4-5 suture here. I can just first forward here. Now fixing the end of the mesh with the peritoneal ligament, taking suture through the mesh and then the peritoneal ligament, and we put the two sutures to fix it with the peritoneal ligament. So and another one suture is little bit loosened here, so I am putting extra one suture also here. This is the corona mortis vein which Dr. Kuntambekar showed in the morning. So bilateral fixation of the end to the peritoneal ligament. So in the sacropaxy we are fixing at the one point only, but in the pectopaxy we are fixing bilaterally both the ends with a strong peritoneal ligament, and the peritoneal ligament is also strong structure. And the principle of the prolapse repair is that the mesh should be fixed to the body structure or the like strong ligament. Like in the sacropaxy, we are fixing on the anterior longitudinal ligament, and in the pectopaxy, we are fixing on the peritoneal ligament. So now just we are closing the peritoneum, because proper peritonization of the mesh is a very important step in the end of surgery. So after completion of surgery, you can see we have just a little bit taken one or two suture through the round ligament also to make it anti-work the uterus. So yes, there is little upliftment of the uterus, but actually I don't find any problem or the patient complain anything after the surgery, and patient is very happy after the surgery, and there is no recurrence rate after the surgery. You can see prolapse is gone well inside, and there is a rugis maintained on the vagina. So this is a very promising procedure, and we can actually test it on the trial basis also, and it is wonderful option for the world prolapse also. You can see this is the case of world prolapse, and we are just putting the gauze pad over the sponge holder, pushing the vault inside and injecting the vasopressin. This makes us actually using the scissors, full scissors, and dissecting the bladder well. So with the uterus and without the uterus, we can use the spectropaxy technique also. And as you, Dr. Ramesh already showed the video in the world prolapse, that we have to separate the bladder well down. And we have to keep our things in the plane only, because if we go more towards the vaginal wall, then maybe there may be chances to mesh erosion into the vagina. Or if we keep ourselves more towards the bladder, then there may be chances of erosion towards the bladder. Because mesh erosion only occurs when we are not in proper plane, or very thin vagina is there, or we have actually disturbed the fascia. Like Dr. Kuntambekar said in the morning, that there is two fascias over every structure. If we are going in the proper plane and not disturbing the visceral fascia, then there is a less chances of erosion and adhesion. So we have to just dissect a little bit posteriorly also to place the mesh, and we can extend this up to the levator ani. In the same manner, we are just opening the peritoneal ligament here also, just below the iliac vein, external iliac vein, and this is the structure where we peritoneal ligament. And in the same way, we will fix here also. So this is actually we are just opening. Here the round ligament is not seen clearly, because it is a post-hysterectomy case. This is the medial obliterated umbilical artery, and medial to this obliterated umbilical artery on the lateral pelvic wall, we find this peritoneal ligament. And we, if we need to, we can cut it also. And this is the mesh design which we put in this case of the vault prolapse. It is a flower leaf pattern, and one end goes anterior vaginal wall, one end goes posterior vaginal wall, and two ends going on the bilateral peritoneal ligament. So it is actually bilateral hemlock-like fixation, and the peritoneal ligament level is S2 level, and vaginal apex is at the only S2 level. In the sacropexy, we are fixing at the S1 level. So we are actually pulling more the vagina, and we are actually making the straight tube by pulling the vagina. And in this case, we are not pulling anything. We are just fixing the 15 centimeter fixed mesh, both the peritoneal ligament, and it is making the hemlock like this way. It is like a jhula. Like we are just supporting the apex or supporting the uterus, and we are not disturbing actually anything, any axis. But it is a presumption that if we are fixing the mesh and pulling mesh it anteriorly, then it may be actually changing the axis. But actually there is no study like that ki there is actually change of the axis is there. Because it's all the presumption that ki, yes, we are fixing anteriorly, so we are pulling anteriorly and it will lift up the vagina and uterus anteriorly and there will be changing the axis, because vagina is more horizontal in the vertical position. When patient is standing, the two-third of the upper part of the vagina is horizontal, not posterior or not anterior. So we are just fixing the mesh on the both the peritoneal ligament and with the two suture. I'm just fast forwarding it. Now we have to close the peritoneum over this, because proper peritonization is must, because any exposure of the mesh may lead to the intestinal adhesion and intestinal obstruction. And number one vicryl or number zero vicryl we can use to close the mesh, re-peritonize the mesh. I'm not able to fast forward this actually. So it is just a completion of the procedure, and you can see the end result of this procedure also. So you can see well supported vault is here, and I don't think any change of the axis is there, because the end are here, but the end result is here. So we are not lifting actually, we are just making the hammock. It's just a point of giving thought, and we can actually try the new method. So you can see we have taken out here the gauze pad from down there, and this is just supporting the uterus here. And there is a point by Dr. B. Ramesh sir saying that there is increased chances of enterocele in these kind of the cases if we are anteriorly fixing it. So we always prefer putting a mascovis suture posteriorly to prevent the enterocele and correction and prevent both. Because actually the prolapse is like that, if you are correcting anterior compartment, the posterior compartment defect will be prominent. Because many a time prolapse coming, anterior prolapse seen after correcting the posterior prolapse, or posterior, after correction of posterior prolapse, there is an anterior prolapse. So actually we have to give the blanket treatment to all the patient, and we should put mascovis suture in case of the pectopexy. So we prevent or treat enterocele simultaneously, and it may actually nullify the effect of anteriorly placed mesh. If it is pulling anteriorly, then it may actually pull posteriorly. But in the case of the pectopexy, there will be no chances of SUI. But I don't know how the literature says that there is chances of pectopexy. Because actually we are not actually changing the urethrovaginal angle. But in the sacropexy, yes. I have seen cases in the sacropexy of SUI. And there is a literature also which supports the pectopexy also. Because there is no risk injury to the nerves and rectum and the ureter. Because we are not touching the posterior compartment here. And this is the port position which we follow. Same like the TLH. And actually we are doing all the posterior repair also if the rectocele is there vaginally. And we actually modify this, actually shorten the, narrow the introitus also. Because in the prolapse cases, there is the broadening of or laxation of the introitus also. So you can see the complete correction we are giving in this case. Like cystocele is taken care by the mesh placement, apical defect is taken care by the placement of the mesh and suspension of the apical suspension of the uterus of the vault. And posterior repair we are performing designally. And because posterior placement of the mesh may lead to the high chances of erosion because of the intercourse or because of more thinning on the posterior vagina. And we are putting the enteromastomy suture also to correct the enteroceles and treat or the prevent the enteroceles. So this is the almost 2 year follow-up study we have done, and there is we don't have and find any apical prolapse again here. Somehow we are lucky enough, or I don't know why. And there is little cystocele, one or two cases of rectocele there. So I usually prefer the pectopexy over sacropexy because it is less invasive. Bilateral fixation of the mesh work like a hammock parallel to the levator ani muscle. Vaginal apex remains at the S2 level, and the direction of the vaginal axis maintained due to the hammock-like placement of the mesh almost parallel to the cardinal ligament. As in the prolapse cases, mainly lengthening of cardinal ligament is there, not of the uterosacral ligament. No interfere with the vital structures as the rectum, ureter, or nerves. And anterior suturing is always easier than the posterior one. And it is very good for the old fragile patient as less time consuming and less morbidity is there. And precautionary mastomy suture placement nullify the so-called assumed anterior pull effect on the anterior placement of the mesh. And vaginal repair of the rectocele with introitus tightening and perineal body reconstruction complete the site-specific repair of the prolapse. Easily duplicable procedure can be performed by the big nurse also. Very less post-op morbidity and fast recovery with the almost nil post-op complication. And mesh placement is very easy in anterior compartment and easy placement of the suture ligament leading to the avoidance of tackers and possible complications. And placement of the mesh in the anterior compartment protect against the central or lateral cystocele and less chances of mesh erosion in anterior compartment than the posterior compartment. And in the wall prolapse cases, vaginal apex fall behind and vaginal angle between upper and lower vagina decreases, but fixation of the apex with pectineal ligament normalizes it. And this is a little bit comparison of sacropexy and the pectopexy. In the sacropexy, we are fixing the mesh at the S1 level because we are fixing it promontory level, not below. But in the pectopexy, the pectineal ligament is S2 level. So I think it is more lower than the sacral level in the pectopexy. And in the sacropexy, we are fixing unilaterally, only right side. So there may be deviation of the vaginal towards the right side. But it is a bilateral fixation and no deviation of the vaginal angle. And vaginal angle change, what I studied, ki there is more obtuse in the sacropexy, 170 to 175 degree. And deviation of vaginal axis, here is no deviation. And this periunia, it is depend on the surgeon's preference, or I don't think it is related to much of the surgery pattern, but what I think is that if the place suture we place on posteriorly fixing the mesh on the cervix or in the POD, and it may lead to the inflammatory reaction because we are placing the suture there, so there may be chances of this periunia because intercourse happen in the posterior fornix of the vagina. And SUI is a reported incidence that is 16 to 38% chances of SUI in sacropexy literature reported cases. And backache is always present, and many times it's a discitis, and many are severe enough to be able to take out the mesh also. Defecation disorder also reported to 17 to 37%, but there is no reporting in the pectopexy. And the success rate is almost same for the both the procedures. So conclusion, ki if you can do sacropexy, and if there is a failure or there is a technical difficulty in doing the cases of sacropexy, like this kind of the cases which I have shown in the SSR also demonstrated. So we can actually prefer the pectopexy if you have difficulty in sacropexy, failure of sacropexy, anterior compartment more defective there, and you are facing the difficulty suturing in posterior compartment, so you can actually prefer take chances or do the pectopexy also. this is the direction of the mesh placement in the pectopexy. Like we are fixing here, this is the patellar ligament starting from the pubic tubercle on the patellar line, and we are just fixing the end here, but mesh goes down below down at the level of the uterus, and this is actually going to S3 S2 level, because patellar ligament is S2 level and the mesh goes more down, like S3 or S4 level, which is the actual level of the vagina. So I don't think we are changing the axis, but it needed the studies, actually proper studies, to research how the changing the axis of the vagina is there. So I don't think it's point of debate, but actually we can try the new method, and if in the failure of the previous cases, then we can actually follow the new technique also. Yeah. Thank you so much. Yeah. And there is expert available to do the discussion on the topic. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Susila. It was a very fantastic and very explanatory presentation. We will take the questions later. Now I will like to invite another great speaker, Dr. Manish Machave. Manish, are you there?
Yes, I am very much there.
Yeah.
Yes. Watching, hearing, very much there.
Let me have a privilege to introduce Manish. He is the gold medalist from the beginning from his Pune University. And he has a dual degree. He is not only MD gynae, he is having LLB degree also. And he is the chairperson of medical legal committee of FOCSI. He is owner of Machave Hospital and consultant in Ruby General Hospital. He is a vice president of Pune Society, organizer of many prestigious events like Star.
And
the most important thing, he is the most wanted speaker on medico-legal issue. And another most important, a person with great sense of humor and always ready to help any of the medico colleague who is in medico-legal tangle. Manish, you are welcome and podium is yours.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. I can see seniors, Ramesh sir is there, Sandesh, all friends. So at the outset, let me thank Sushila for, you know, allowing me to talk on something which is not medico-legal. So because a lot of my talks or almost all of my talks are always medico-legal. So this is something which is not medico-legal. So thank you. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
We know, Dr. Manish, you are a very good endoscopic surgeon and we love to see your videos and surgery always.
Thank you so much.
Somehow,
Thank you so much. So, without much ado, I pray to Lord Ganesha to sail me through this presentation. This is me. Talk given to me today is Birch Colpo Suspension or Transobturator Tip. So, I have a few caveats before I actually start. Laparoscopic Birch for genuine SUI is the procedure of my choice. So that is a caveat I want to put. Presence of, the status of TVT as it came, transvaginal tape, then transobturator tape, then transvaginal tape obturator, which later came on with the pusher and all, because of mesh issues is slightly query. So if we have time after the video, we'll definitely discuss that. And we will concentrate on surgery and not on evidence. So I have evidence. And if the time permits, I will show you those evidences also. Now we will skip few of those slides because everybody knows about this. The whole concept is, the issue is that the incidence of SUI is, you know, not quoted very properly, especially in India, for a simple reason that a lot of females will not tell you. They will not tell you about this, they will hide it. And as the age progresses, it comes down in the families and they are told that this is something which is going to happen with age, with deliveries. And wrong things are put, you know, they are propagated, like drink less of water, you know, and put pad inside and do not tell anybody. So it is something which is really underreported. And although it was coined as early as this term was coined in 1922, some slides we'll skip. There is a grading of SUI, then there are different types of SUI. So more or less, it is coming to an issue where you have genuine stress urinary incontinence, which in simple terms means that whenever there is increased intra-abdominal pressure, some or lot of urine leaks out through the urethra because of two major issues. One issue is there is urethral hypermobility. That means the urethra is no longer a part of the abdomen and it comes down. And the second is there is intrinsic sphincter deficiency. So either it's an ISD or a urethral hypermobility. These are two important things that we have to keep in mind with respect to deciding the treatment. And then there are so many classifications which we can, you know, if you want to do urodynamic studies, so on and so forth. So truthfully, I have done these urodynamic studies for all my patients. Hardly I understood anything. The only thing was at the end of it, what diagnosis they are giving, because there's a lot of things which go on while these kind of studies are done. And there are a lot of theories. So you have a pressure transmission theory, which we have to understand that in case the urethra is there inside the pelvis and with the bladder there, whatever increase intra-abdominal pressure happens, it increases the intravesical as well as the intraurethral pressure. So they counter each other, nothing happens. As soon as there is urethral hypermobility and the urethra moves downwards, the urethra comes down, the increased intra-abdominal pressure will rise the intravesical pressure, but it will, you know, do nothing to the urethra, which will open up and there will be dribbling of urine. Then there is DeLance's hammock hypothesis, and this is something which we put our head into when we try to do Birch or retropubic procedures, Marshall Marchetti Kranz and so on and so forth. So this is the hammock hypothesis. And then we also have intrinsic sphincter deficiency with so many reasons given, previous surgeries, delivery, so on and so forth. And this forms the basis of injecting bulking agents, either transurethrally or side of the urethra, so as to increase or strengthen the sphincter. So basically, we are talking about two things, intrinsic sphincter deficiency and urethral hypermobility. Urethral hypermobility being the commonest. And these are the different reasons for urethral hypermobility and intrinsic sphincter deficiency. Now, to diagnose, it is not very difficult. Very important thing is that stress urinary incontinence will lot of times coexist with urge incontinence. And if you do not treat the urge incontinence first, your surgery is bound to fail. Your surgery will not fail because it will correct the SUI, but the urge incontinence remains. So that is something which we have to find out and treat. Essentially, the treatment of stress urinary incontinence is surgery. Essentially, the treatment of urge incontinence is medicine. So we have to find that. And all there are so many tests. So we all know this Boney's test, Yusuf's test. Very important is do a urine examination to rule out cystitis. You have a Q-tip test and all the different angles, and you do the blood test, so on and so forth. And as I told you, there is a non-surgical management of SUI with respect to lifestyle modifications, so on and so forth, devices, bulking agents around the urethra. And then there is surgical management. There are a whole lot of surgeries, huge number of surgeries which can be offered. The American Urology Association is very clear. Now, there are some guidelines which are very clear, and I, for one, like clear-cut guidelines. So they say, when Kegels exercises are ineffective, patient desires definitive treatment, you offer one of these five. And it is very clear what you offer. So they say either you offer laparoscopic Birch, you offer injectable bulking agents, or mid-urethral pubovaginal slings. Now, to the sling part, we will come a little later because it involves the mesh, so on and so forth. We will skip all these pleasantries and probably, you know, go to the video, because that is where we will discuss. So patient preparation is obviously you need informed consent. First off, you need to have a clear-cut diagnosis of genuine stress urinary incontinence, meaning whereby, again, I'll put it very clearly, that increased intra-abdominal pressure with respect to coughing, sneezing, or sometimes even walking, standing, moving, changing position will cause the dribbling of urine. And that is in absence of any detrusor contractility. So detrusor is not irritated, detrusor is not contracting, but still you have this loss. So genuine stress urinary incontinence is a diagnosis to be made very clearly, rule out urge incontinence, and then go on with all this. So NBM bowel preparation is as usual, single intravenous dose 1 hour before of antibiotic 1 hour before surgery. I generally stand on the left side. So this is how we do. Important thing is one assistant has to stand in between the legs of the patient, because we need to lift the para urethral tissues and make them very clearly visible before taking any stitch. GA is generally given. A Foley's catheter is a must here for two reasons. You have to fill the bladder, and then you have to also recognize the UV junction. So once you empty the bladder, pull the Foley's, you know where the urethrovesical junction is, and paravaginal tissues can then be lifted. Scrubbing and draping is as usual. These are the port positions. Some people use suprapubic ports, but generally, because I do ipsilateral suturing, so I put two ports on my side, one port on the opposite side, and a central port for the camera. Okay, so we'll just go to the procedure and just see it. So important point again is this is something which can be done along with a total laparoscopic hysterectomy. It can be done in when the uterus is absent. It can be done with the uterus in situ, so on and so forth. So we can do it at any time, you know, for, you know, varied kind of situations. Hadistoika, is this video seen?
No, not seen.
Now? Is the video seen now? Hello?
Not seen.
Okay, okay.
No.
Okay, okay. Is the video seen now?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So as I told you, we have two ipsilateral ports, 5 mm, one contralateral port, 5 mm. And now this is a case where a previously vaginal hysterectomy was done and this patient had genuine stress urinary incontinence. Now, some little adhesions that can be removed without a problem. Important part now here is that once you start the surgery, the first thing is to develop the retropubic space or the space of radius, for which it is very important to fill the bladder. Because once you fill the bladder falls down. And then it is very easy not to injure the bladder. A lot of people will fill the bladder with methylene blue. So if there is any injury, it is recognized. But that is something which we have not done. Even if you fill the bladder with 200 cc's of saline, it falls down. And this plane is very good to achieve. There aren't many blood vessels or anything there. It is just fat and it is just a small tissue which can be dissected. So you can dissect it with bipolar scissors or you can dissect it with harmonic, whichever way. Now here you can very clearly see the bladder margin. Now important part in dissection of this is that at the margin of the bladder, there is a persistent vein on either side. Now that is something which you need to recognize and, you know, keep away from that vein. I have seen sometimes the vein starts to bleed and you cannot, you know, do anything to it other than just put pressure. So there is a persistent vein on the side of the bladder and then there is nothing. So as long as you keep the bladder away, very slowly you keep on dissecting and you go to the iliopectineal ligament of Cooper. When you do a pectopexy, you have the external iliac vein there and you have the corona mortis. There's nothing here. So it is not a very difficult dissection. It is quite an easy dissection to do. And iliopectineal ligament of Cooper is something which is called the lighthouse of the pelvis, because the moment you see it, it appears like a bright glistening structure. So you cannot miss it. And again, there aren't any major vessels there. Now, this is the dissection which we do too, because we have to find out where the urethrovesical junction is. And the paraurethral tissues or the paravaginal tissues around the urethra have to be picked up from there. In the Marshall Marchetti Kranz or MMK procedure, these tissues are then, you know, the suspended to the posterior part of symphysis pubis, but that is to produce a lot of osteitis. Now, this is something your assistant will do from below. The assistant will put a finger in lateral fornix and very slowly with sharp and blunt dissection, you can, dissect off all the bladder tissues away on that finger. Now, other than the finger, you can also use a sponge. Some people use Hagar's dilator. See that vein? See, this is the vein I was talking about. So that is something which you need to be avoiding very carefully. And some people use Hagar's dilator, but I think assistant's finger is a very good, way of knowing. Now, again, so now here we know this is the place where the bladder ends and the urethra starts. So we have to pick up the paraurethral tissues and then it is a colpus suspension procedure. So we have to suspend it to the iliopectineal ligament of Cooper. So what suture material do we use? We use Ethibond 20. It's a polyester suture. Now, what suture you can also use is you can use any non-absorbable. You can use proline also there. That's not a problem. Now, what we are trying to do here is we pass the suture through the paravaginal tissues twice so that, you know, it gets fixed properly. And whatever little there is, sometimes a little bleeding, you can ignore it and do not try to coagulate in that region. It is not needed at all. Important point about colpus suspension is when you suspend this, you have to put the suture at least 4 cm away from symphysis pubis, because you don't want this to land up anteriorly. You have to pull the urethra up. So this is how we go through the ligament and the direction. Once I am tying, you will see. Important part is you have to pull the urethra up. And as I told you, the urethra has gone down. So you have to pull the urethra up, and also when the urethra comes inside the abdomen, and then take it upwards. Now, when you are tightening this knot, it should not be tightened in a way that the paravaginal tissues go and stick to the iliopectineal ligament of Cooper. That will not happen. What will happen is if you try to tighten it too much, it will give a cutting effect. There will be tearing. So that is not something which we want. So what we want is a sling. It is a colpus suspension. It has to be a sling-like effect. So every time there is increased intra-abdominal pressure, every time there is rise in this pressure because of coughing, sneezing or whatever, this colpus suspension will suspend. It will pull up the paravaginal tissues and it will pull the urethra up so that the same pressure which increases intravesical pressure will also increase the intraurethral pressure. Correction of angle will take place and there will be no stress urinary incontinence. Now, how many sutures to put? Whether one suture is enough, two sutures on either side are enough, or three sutures are enough, that is a point of debate. What we have done is, it's not a very big series, maybe 30 odd cases, where in few cases we have put only one properly taken suture and few cases we have put two sutures. It is the place at which you put the suture is more important than how many sutures you put. If you have put the suture correctly, now in this case, you are watching, this is a case where we have put two sutures on either side. So two sutures on left side, two sutures on right side. As long as you are putting the sutures in a proper place, as long as these sutures are, you know, properly put through the iliopectineal ligament and not tightened too much. If you see the previous suture which I have put, it is not tightened too much. And the only issue is pulling the urethra up and then taking it to the iliopectineal ligament of Cooper. Now this, as I told you, corrects the urethral hypermobility. So here, again, we are going through the ligament. I cannot forward this. So please bear with me. If possible, I'll not play the other video and finish with this one. So the idea here is to use non-absorbable. I have found this Ethibond suture to be slightly better. Proline suture has a lot of memory. So putting sutures becomes a little difficult. And this Ethibond is okay. The memory in Ethibond is slightly less. So whatever sutures you put, you can put them very fast and very clean. When you are putting the suture, another important point is do not go through the vagina through and through, because you do not want a non-absorbable suture to come through the vagina, which will irritate the patient and be a cause of lot of leukorrhea later. And that patient will come and eat your head. So be very sure how much thickness you are taking. And again, important point is still you are putting the suture, if your assistant's finger is there, it helps, because if you are putting the suture from there or your needle is coming from there, that person will inform you that, you know, you need to remove it and put it in another. That now you can see the nicely lifted at two places here. And the same procedure is then repeated on the other side. And once these are, again, so here you can see this is a persistent vein I was talking about. And in one or two cases, I have injured that vein and it bleeds quite horribly. You cannot put a cautery, you cannot do anything there because it's the bladder. So be very careful about that vein. Again, it is the place where you put the suture is more important. So you are putting the suture right at a place which is going to pull the urethra up. And that is what is, you know, expected. Now, this is the back of or the symphysis pubis. Now, where you put the suture is around 3 or 4 centimeter away from the symphysis pubis. You do not want that suture to, you know, not pull the urethra up. So I think this is all whatever is happening. Just bear with me. I think 2 more minutes, this will get over. So important point here is that the patient is under GA. So you cannot ask the patient and, you know, do any test to see whether it is leaking or not. That is the whole gamut. Again, I have seen people use methylene blue here so that, you know, they would see that whether there is any injury to the bladder or no injury to the bladder. But what we do is we put a hysteroscope after the surgery is over into the bladder and just see the bladder from inside and if there is any bleeding or anything or any injury. So doing a cystoscopy after this birth suspension is a very easy way of knowing whether something has gone wrong. So this is one case where we have put two sutures on either side. Fortunately for us, all these patients were well investigated and none of them has come with any recurrence or any failure. And as I told you, this is a case where a vaginal hysterectomy was previously done. We have done it with total laparoscopic hysterectomy and we have done it where the uterus is intact. So uterus is in place and patient only has SUI and no problem with the uterus. So even in those cases, we have done. If this is, I don't know. Maybe I need to learn how to fast forward this. Just a part I have to show you is the cystoscopy, because once you finish this and then you close this entire thing with Vicryl and it's continuous sutures and that's it. Okay. So we will skip the cystoscopy part. There is a little bit of bleeding, but good suction. And the best thing is to put in a fiber bundle or a gauze and give pressure. There is no point in putting any energy source or anything there. And what sutures you put, generally try to put them parallel. So they should look mirror image of each other on either side. I have seen people put or I have seen videos where they've put 3 or 4 sutures also. Again, the basic thing is that it is not how many sutures, it is at what point you put the suture is very extremely important. And that point is the one which you should choose very clearly. That is why the Foley's helps. So once you've emptied the bladder, you pull the Foley's, you clearly understand where your urethrovesical angle is. Right. Okay. Okay, so this is one more video. I'll not play it completely. The other video only had a cystoscopy clip attached to it after closure of the peritoneum. The cystoscopy showed that everything is all good. Now, this is one video which is showing that there is uterus. So it doesn't matter your dissection or your procedure or your steps of the procedure. It doesn't matter. You know, you can do it with TLH, as I told you, and with the uterus, without the uterus. Now, this is one case where we had put only one stitch. Now, again, there is a debate of one or two, but what we do is, what we are trying to do is, there is a classification which classifies SUI, according to its severity. So it says that if you have, you know, SUI only on strenuous work or on moderate work or on mild work, or SUI happens only even if you just stand up. So we have selected cases where SUI only happens if there's very strenuous activity otherwise, and then we put only one stitch in those cases. And for severe cases, we put 2 stitches, and then we will, you know, over a period of time, it's been only 5-6 months, I think. But maybe after 1 or 2 years, we'll come up and see what happens. So this is exactly the same dissection, which shows that only one suture is put. So we can skip this. Discharge of the patient is next day. We keep the patient overnight. NSAIDs can be given. Only important thing is you have to ask the patient to avoid any strenuous work for at least 8 weeks after this surgery. There are some non-surgical treatments in the form of some medicines, but again, the literature doesn't, provide very good evidence that these medicines are going to work. Some people have used pessaries also, and this is what I was talking about, the injectable. So you have intrinsic sphincter deficiency, you inject bulking agents either transurethrally or paraurethrally and see what happens. This is also one way of treating. Now coming to the issue of slings. Now, the great debate is about laparoscopy. Birch was first, done open with an open surgery, and now we do it laparoscopically. So the whole debate is about minimally invasive. So laparoscopic birch versus slings. So initially we had the transvaginal tape, the tension-free tape which had come, and then we had transobturator tape, and then this transobturator thing was completely replacing the transvaginal, and then another company with the help of a slider got the TVTO. Now, these are all the different types of slings. So if you compare, so suppose you go and find out systematic reviews or Cochrane and put evidence into it, everybody will say that these slings are way better than doing a laparoscopic birch with respect to cure rates, with respect to less of recurrence, ease of performing, and being minimally invasive or almost non-invasive. So if you do, for example, a transobturator tape, which is absolutely very little invasive, only one small cut on the vagina and that's it. So all of them will definitely support them. But this review is something which tells us the truth. So this is a 2015 obstetric gynec review. It says that there is little doubt that the data to support the mid-urethral slings as the gold standard in surgical management, birch colpus suspension remains a safe and effective alternative to mid-urethral slings. But herein comes the twist. It says that patients should be made aware of this non-mesh option. So why this non-mesh option and why this kind of statement was there? Because of this. The US FDA in 2008, they, you know, printed and said that there are serious complications associated with transvaginal placement of surgical meshes. And why they said this was a lot of litigation started coming. Again, 2011, they said that serious complications associated with transvaginal placement of surgical mesh for pelvic organ prolapse. In 2016, the FDA came out with a classification and they said that doing this kind of surgery using a mesh for SUI, although they did not include SUI initially, but they said it is a class 3 device and no other surgical procedures can also be preferred. And why this came up was because of this lot of litigations. In 2012, a 53-year-old female who had a mesh erosion was given 5.5 million as compensation. Again, in 2014, around 16 million and 1.3 billion was the total amount of dollars which went in compensation because of mesh-associated issues. So the whole gamut is, if it is a mesh, it is creating problems. But here in India, you know, we do not have our own data or our own statement. There are a lot of position statements. So you have American Urology Association, you have Society of Urodynamics, and all them, they have their supportive statements for placement of multi-incision monofilament and urethral slings, and they have their statements. But the, what FDA said stays, and what has happened in court stays. So mesh all over the world is becoming a slight problem, especially for SUI, because of chances of erosion and litigations. The questions that we have to answer, and that is why I said in the beginning, was that although I have done transobturator tape, but my procedure of choice remains laparoscopic birth. The questions in India that we have to seek answers for is, does FOCSI or IAG have our position statement? What happens to the, are there any randomized trials between the vaginal procedures and laparoscopic birth in India? Do we have enough training through CMEs or at PG level, as much as for laparoscopic procedures and vaginal procedures? And what is the cost and what are the limitations if there are litigations, and what will happen? The day we will be able to solve this question, this debate, what Sushila has given me, laparoscopic birth or TOT will get solved. As on now, the issue with meshes remain. As on now, you, if you ask me, laparoscopic birth remains my procedure of choice. And both of them are, one is you know, like a predator and other one is an alien. We are entering into a category where only urologists were doing it. Now we are doing it. We are doing it very well. That's not a problem. But which one to select? I'm so sure so many here, seniors and everybody, would swear by a transobturator tape and kill me for saying that laparoscopic birth kyun karta hai saale. But that is what it is. Thank you so much, Sushila. Thank you for involving me in such a great feast of academics. And I've been listening to everybody since yesterday. Thank you so much.
Yeah, it was a very hello. It was a very lecture by Manish. So please remain with us for the discussion. Yes. Yeah. Next, our next speaker is Dr. Samir Pradhan. Dr. Samir, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there. Yeah, I think Manish has to stop share screen.
Yeah, Dr. Samir is a gold medalist from SETH GS Medical College. He is a director of Samarth Nursing Home. And a personal comment, he is a person who makes the conferences very lively with his logical discussions. He is, I like him for his this particular...
Sorry, yeah, for barging in, sir, but Dr. Samir is one person who keeps all, everyone, the seniors, juniors, all presenters on their toes.
On the
because
toes.
They are, everybody is looking at Samir. Abhi ye kya puchne wala hai?
Puchne wala, exactly.
Yeah, hello. Thank you so much for the kind words of this. I'll just start sharing my screen. And I was told to have a video presentation by Dr. Sushila. Thank you so much, Sushila, for involving me in this talk. And after this plethora of laparoscopic talks, I think my talk will be very dry. But now there was a controversy raised about mesh, non-mesh. So for the juniors and for the other people who don't want to get in the controversies, I will share the vaginal ways of repairing of prolapse. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, we can hear you.
And my video is playing, right? So I'll be covering vaginal hysterectomy, anterior colporrhaphy, posterior colporperineal, certain strategies for post-hysterectomy wall prolapse prevention, and certain other surgeries like sacrospinous and Lefort's colpocalysis. Now, starting with vaginal hysterectomy, why it is actually required? It is a primary pathology in the uterovaginal prolapse, and the supra or infravaginal elongated cervix can be hypertrophied or ulcerated. So, procedentia, unless you remove the uterus, you cannot do a proper repair, and you cannot do a proper pelvic diaphragm repair in the procedentia where the fundus is also outside. So, coming to vaginal hysterectomy, I am skipping the main steps. The A and P pouch are already open. The left uterosacral has been taken, and here we are showing the right uterosacral ligament being taken. It is clamped, cut, and transfixed with a Hinis type of transfixation. Number one, Vicryl, and we always go around, and the uterosacral pedicles are kept long. Subsequently, the left uterine is taken. This pedicle is kept short. The right uterine has been taken, and here we are seeing the converse being taken. Nowadays, we make a point to remove the fallopian tubes vaginally. You can see the Shade's clamp being applied there in all cases. So what can be done laparoscopically can also be done vaginally. The main precautions for prolapse start after the hysterectomy. We always do peritonization with a high ligation of P pouch. So here we are seeing the anterior peritoneum being taken. And then the posteriorly we'll go up to the high ligation of P pouch. The fat layer is the guiding point where we know it is high ligation. It's like a Moshkowitz done from below. So this will prevent an enteroseal. I always take a McCall stitch. McCall stitch starts from the left hand side, the left vaginal angle, the left uterosacral, then the peritoneum, the right uterosacral ligament, and then the right vaginal angle. This stitch is taken with number one. Some of them have taken internal McCall's with a non-absorbable proline stitch if it's a slightly more big central defect. But this stitch is not tied immediately. Next, we tie both the uterosacrals which were kept long to each other, and that end also is kept long. After this, for the anterior compartment, that is the central cystocele, we do something called anterior colporaphy, which we have been doing since our first post. The main steps for anterior colporaphy will be to hold the vaginal edges in this triangular manner, and the apex is at the apex of the cystocele. We don't repair the urethrocele. We can infiltrate cold saline or saline with adrenaline or saline with vasopressin in the plane just below the epithelial margin so that it helps in hydrodissection, and it also takes care of small oozers from the vaginal edge. We take an inverted T-shaped incision, and we start the dissection on a P repair where we have to dissect the pubo-vesico-cervical fascia from the vaginal epithelium. We are going to use this fascia to plicate, so it is going to be a native tissue repair. So the vaginal epithelium is kept very thin. There was a period when Professor Shlomo Raz had come and Professor Ajay Rani had come, and that time they used to put mesh, which is now banned, as Manish said. That time the vaginal epithelium used to be kept thick, but here we again keep it thin. So both the flaps are raised. We have to achieve the hemostasis then and there. And now we start plicating the pubo-vesico-cervical fascia. We have to go at the junction between the vaginal edge and the cystocele. One can take a stepwise pattern, or here I'm taking like a purse string suture. We cannot go very deep, or the needle might go in the bladder. And we have to lift the pubo-vesico-cervical fascia. And when we tighten it, we have to make the first knot square and then subsequently two or three more throws. But at that particular point of time, we also follow the same principles of vertical zone suturing. So our you can see our movement of the fingers will be at 12 o'clock and 6 o'clock, and the assistant will push the rectocele inside. We can take one extra more suture if there's a small cystocele remaining. In the youth cystocele, I have started taking concentric layers of pubocervical fascia. So the support is in three layers instead of a single layer. That is some modification which we have been doing since last 2 to 3 years. And we always have started doing this Denon Villiers fascia plication so as to prevent a enteroseal or a wall prolapse in future. This is an extra step which we never used to do earlier. The vaginal trimming is done, but now we do less trimming because of the studies which say that vagina should not be shortened too much. It remodels itself. And then the vagina is sutured with 2-0 Vicryl. One can also use a zero number chromic catgut. It can be taken in a continuous interlocking manner, but I prefer to take an interrupted manner. This is from my Dr. Sarogi's notes of when I appeared for my MD. Taking a continuous suture for the vagina anteriorly will shorten its length and may cause a de novo stress or urge incontinence. So I have been following that since the last 23 years, and I take it interrupted, figure of eight or a vertical mattress suture. After this, the main thing, this is the last stitch of the A repair of the vertical limb. Then comes the main part. We have to anchor the uterosacrals, which are kept long, to the vaginal vault. So here we take a bare stout Mayo's needle with a big eye, and we re-thread the uterosacral pedicles in that, and we go posteriorly deep so that there is no dead space, which otherwise it can cause a hematoma in that dead space. And then we go to the apex of the vaginal vault to the apex of the vault where the vaginal vault and A repair meet. So this we will be doing from both the uterosacral pedicles. This will be our main. It will be similar to an internal McCall stitch. So we don't take more than one McCall stitch because this is, we are anyway going to anchor. There have been various other ways of anchoring the vault, but I do the standard way always. Even this stitch, particular stitch, we don't tie immediately. We tie it after the vault, the transverse part of the vault is sutured. So this is just approximation, which will be tightening later so that the vault will go up. And now we are suturing the angle of the vaginal vault. And this is the end of the vault suturing. After this, we are going to tighten the uterosacrals and push the vault inside. And then we can just tie the vault suture to the uterosacral pedicles so as to obliterate the dead space further. All these extra sutures will also cause fibrosis and prevent recurrence. And at that particular point of time, we tie the McCall stitch, and this all will help into preventing a relapse of the prolapse. So summarizing the points which we have taken, these are the instruments which we use, Landon's. A broader version is called Purandare's. And the steps are a high ligation of pea pouch, repair of enteroseal like a Moskowitz from below, the plication of denominalis fascia at the apex, tying both the uterosacral pedicles, anchoring the pedicles to the vault, and a McCall scaldoplasty. So doing all this, then by and large, there is no incidence of vault prolapse, even during long-term follow-up. Now in the next video, we'll be seeing the posterior colpopenography with a sacrospinous fixation. It was done for a vault prolapse surgery. So here again, we raise the posterior flaps. Dissection is like the dissection for a P repair where we infiltrate saline adrenaline between the posterior vaginal wall and the rectovaginal fascia. But in case of this vault prolapse, one has to go up to the apex of the vault, and here one has to be very careful because the rectum, the curve of the rectum is very near, and if one goes deep, one can injure the rectum because we know the rectum has those lateral curves. And here we are seeing the plication of the denominalis fascia. One need not open the peritoneum. But if it's a large peritoneal sac, then one can open it like a hernia sac and reduce the enteroseal contents and then tighten it. So here the denominalis fascia has been taken by a purse string suture. And this end, we start the P repair by taking the angle, and the denominalis fascia is stitch is tied to that angle. So we take care of the dead space. Now we start the dissection to expose the right sacrospinous ligament, or that is the thickened part of the ischiococcygeus muscle. We have held three Allis forceps and we are dissecting. We can dissect with a cold scissors, or here it added with a cautery. The fibers of the rectovaginal fascia are dissected off from the vagina, and one has to now perforate the rectal pillar. So this is a sweeping movement which has been done on the rectum, and the rectum has to be swept medially. Then we use these few pillars of the rectal, the fibers which are supporting the vagina to the rectum are cut so as to get more space. And we put a neurothelial retractor, a small devise, and a single bedded sims. And we can see the sacrospinous ligament being exposed. We have to be two fingers medial to that so as to be away from the internal pudendal artery and the pudendal nerve. We don't have any Capio device. So in a small needle holder, we hold it like a zero number proline, non-observable, as if we are holding a straight needle and we take to a helical suture to the apex. A test can be done where we can pull the patient and see the whole patient moving. Since it is a proline suture, it cannot come in the cavity of the vagina, so it has to be taken subepithelially. And this suture will be tied later on. So now we complete the P repair. And once we complete the P repair, the last stitch has been taken. Then we will have to tighten the sacrospinous ligament. It's a proline suture, so we have to use the principles of tightening where the first throw is a double throw and then subsequently five more throws. While tightening, one should not use too much pressure. It will break the stitch and the whole surgery will get failed. And slowly the vault has to go towards the apex with a pulley-like action. We have already taken a Levitanized stitch that is to support the level 3 D-lances support that has been tied, and this is the end of P repair. Certain instruments which are required are a Briskin auratal retractor, an angulated Landon's retractor, and these are the few complications of this surgery. That's why one has to be very careful of the internal pudendal vessels and the pudendal nerve. So some of these patients have a post-op gluteal pain. Now this is one modification which we do for procedentia where we can combine a vaginal hysterectomy with a Lefort's colpocklysis. The prerequisite is the patient should not be sexually active for this obliterative vaginal surgeries like Lefort's, and there is something called a Goodall-Powers modification of Lefort's. So these are also can be done for wall prolapse. This is a case of procedentia where initially we have infiltrated anteriorly and posteriorly. This was done in the live surgery workshop at the Thane Obstetric Gynec Society at Kalwa Hospital. So my thing is to cover the picture in picture. That's why my name is coming on the left corner. So we have raised rectangular flaps anteriorly and posteriorly. Again, these flaps have to be thin because we are going to use native tissue to repair the defect. Here the one has to give head low so that the bowel goes up and opens the pee pouch under vision. Now in a procedentia, the uterus is atrophic, so tissue identification is very difficult and it becomes still more difficult after you infiltrate. So some of them don't infiltrate, but then it causes a lot of bleeding from the vaginal edges. And these cases are long standing. So here on a finger pass through the posterior fornix, one can identify the anterior sac and it is opened under vision. And in a non-descent hysterectomy, one can take the uterosacrals first and then open the pouches. But in the procedentia, one always have to open the pouches first because the fundus of the uterus is outside. So the uterines also come down. As the uterines come down, they pull the ureters also down. So unless this lateral vagina is excised, the A and P pouch are excised, the, till that time you should not take the uterosacrals. So rest of the hysterectomy is completed as routine. Here we again seen the left corner being taken. We can remove the tubes and ovaries also from below nowadays. We are doing it routinely for last 10 years. I have a video of that on the YouTube if anybody is interested. And for a bigger pedicle, one has to go from center and tie on both sides. Here again, we are showing the plication, the closure of the visceral peritoneum with a high ligation. So here the Landon's retractor is replaced by a broader one called Purandaris because the tissues otherwise keep on falling. If the bowel is coming in the way, one has to use a roller pack, which is Dr. Sherry Shet's favorite. One should not use another pack or a gauze piece because it can get lost in the cavity. And here we are doing a ligation, but here even after this ligation in such a case, the whole sac will still be outside. The uterosacrals will be approximated, but still it will not serve the purpose. That is why a lot of people in the abroad have shifted to those mesh plastics because they don't have expertise of vaginal surgeries. And unfortunately in India, we don't have any studies. So now we have got a good new group, which I urge all of you to be members. It is called SAUSI, Society of Vaginal Surgeons of India, started by Dr. Mahapatra. And we have started doing a lot of activities for teaching all the people about vaginal surgeries, especially in this post-COVID era where all these surgeries can be done under regional anesthesia and GA is not required and no smoke evacuation is required. So after this step, we start approximating the pubocervical fascia to the rectovaginal fascia. This is a traditional Lefort's colpocklysis. So as one has to be very patient, one has to take the fascia in a box-like stitch, and the similar box-like stitch which Sanket mentioned in the panel discussion. This was taught to us by Dr. Rakesh Sinha. One has to be very careful when here we're taking the pubo-cervico-basilical fascia. And then we are going below. So we are plicating the fascia and we are going layer by layer. All these box stitches are at different layers. It is similar to a mason who is going to do brickwork. He does not keep stack all the bricks one above the other. They put it in a zigzag manner. So that gives more support. Here we are taking the rectovaginal fascia. And then we'll, when we are going to tighten this by a proper first square knot and then subsequently three more knots, the assistant will have to push the prolapse inside. So ultimately what we are going to create is we are going to create a native tissue bridge. This can be done with the in the case when the uterus need not be removed, that time we have to keep a tunnel on the lateral side where a rubber cutter is placed. This tunnel on the lateral tunnel side on the, both the sides, it helps for the cervical secretions to drain. So in a patient who is not fit for surgery, this surgery can be done under local anesthesia also, where one skips the hysterectomy part and just does the Lefort's colpocolysis. I will try to fast forward, but I don't know whether it can be done. Yeah. So here the prolapse is getting reduced as we tighten. And this is another almost the final layers of the pubo-basilical cervical fascia. One should not go very deep inside, otherwise one can cause fistulae later on. So one has to be use a 2-0 Vicryl. Needle is very thin. 2317 is the code number, and the assistant is pushing the tissue inside as I tighten it by the first square knot and subsequent three more knots. Then the last anterovaginal wall is sutured to the posterior vaginal wall. And one can see at this particular point of time, the lateral labial sutures have to be removed. So otherwise it can cause cut through. And the whole prolapse, which was lying completely outside, has been reduced. In a Goodall-Powers modification, the triangular flaps are raised. So patient has some vagina for sexual activity, but in a Lefort's, there is hardly any vagina left. We are seeing the vaginal edge has been approximated. And after this particular surgery, I always prefer to do a posterior colpoperineography with two levetiranus stitches. The levetiranus stitch and the superficial transverse perineus stitch help to reinforce the delancy level 3 support, and it helps to prevent a recurrence of prolapse. So this is the final picture where the P repair has been done. One, I always keep a pack for 24 hours. In a wall prolapse, a similar surgery can be done where the flaps are raised anteriorly and posteriorly. And then as we serially tighten, the wall prolapse gets reduced. So in an elderly patient who is comorbid, who has a very thin vagina, where the mesh complications can have a risk, this is a very good surgery. There are certain newer approaches. High uterosacral ligament suspension can be done vaginally, but one has to take care of the ureters because it is a middle part of the uterosacral where ureter is very close. So one can take the laparoscopy support. And one of my friends, Dr. Sunil Doshi, who is a urogynec surgeon from India, he has gone and settled in UK. He had shown in a live workshop of Fox Saucy a paravaginal defect repair, which is for lateral or rotatory systocele. Most of the times the systocele recurs because the pubo-basilico-cervical fascia detaches from the arcus tendinous fascia pelvis. And we have not been taught to re-anchor this. Nowadays, some people do it laparoscopically, but he had shown it can be done vaginally also. They use a surgesis, that is a biomesh, which is not available in India, but it can be done. And they have a specific site-specific repair with a proper evidence-based studies, where for anterior, they don't remove the uterus. They preserve the pubis or the cervical rim. And for a central systocele, they attach the pubo-cervical fascia to the pericervical rim. And for a rectocele, they attach the rectovaginal fascia to the pericervical rim. I have seen this being done at my place by sir, but we have no, we have to have a training as Manish had said in his last slide, and then only we can start these newer approaches. I thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to show the scope of vaginal surgeries also in prolapse. Thank you for a patient here.
Samir. Yeah. It was, hello.
Yeah, sir.
It was a fantastic presentation.
Thank you so much.
And we should, we Indians are famous for vaginal surgery, and we are glad that you are keeping this flame alive.
Yeah, thank you so hello. Much, sir. Yeah, sir. I urge everybody hello. To be a member of SAUSI. Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, you can.
Yes. Yeah. So there is a new society which is formed, and everybody should be a member. We have to be a comprehensive gynecologist. We should be able to do laparoscopy as well as vaginal, not be compartmentalized. Okay, thank you so much. Hello.
Samir, can you hear me?
Yeah, very much.
Samir, I have also done few leaflets. The only issue is these females land up with SUI sometimes.
Yeah, that is one known complication of leaflets.
So, would at the same time doing a calliplication help?
So, calliplication is out. Means, as you said, calliplication was in the era when the posterior UV angle was supposed to be the cause of stress incontinence. When we did our post-graduation, subsequently, I think as you showed in your things, now the problem is in the mid-urethral support.
Yeah.
There is something called occult incontinence. So all my cases of prolapse, the prolapse itself can prevent a SUI, which is occult, being obvious because the bladder is below the urethra, that itself causes kinking. So when any case with such a huge prostudentia, one should counsel this patient. Once the whole, I show them with drawings, once the whole anatomy is restored and the bladder comes back to its normal position, then because the defects were weak, she may have a stress incontinence de novo after the surgery. And I, as you said in your learning, I have not seen a burst ever, only in conferences I have seen, but I started doing TOTs, but then TOTs cause a lot of pain. So I shifted back to nowadays to TVT exact. All normally urodynamic is suggested. The main thing is to rule out a detrusor dyssynergia, because it will get aggravated by any TVT or TOT, as you said, rightly said. And also if there's an element of intrinsic sphincter deficiency, the TVT, that is a retropubic sling with the proper cystoscopy, may help to some extent, but a TOT will definitely not help in a intrinsic sphincter deficiency. So these patients, we tell them, let the fibrosis occur, let 1 year go. If they have a detrusor dyssynergia, one can give those dual solifenacin, daridorphenacin, or nowadays we have that mirabegron. Counsel them. We can also give a short course of dual oxytin, and then we counsel them for a urodynamic study, and then I do a TVT exact. But if you are going to do a laparoscopic sacral colpopexy for a wall prolapse, you may have to do this. But then I don't know how you will be elicited doing a urodynamic study with the prolapse in situ. It's very difficult.
Can I add here something?
Yes, please.
Yes, Sandesh.
This question was raised both by Manish as well as Sushila, that after pectopexy also she says that literature says there is SUI. And you are also saying the same thing. But after correction of leaflets, these patients have incontinence. So basically, it is noted that initially these patients are leaking, they have SUI. But as the bladder also comes out, it goes into an obstructive phenomenon. So what Samir is using the word mass, occult, it is a masked prolapse. Means the cystocele is actually kinking the urethrovesical angle, and that's why the patient has stopped leaking, but actually the leak is still there. The bladder neck is already outside the lower down. So when you push the cystocele inside, then the hypermobile urethra or the urethrovesical angle is still at fault, and that's why they start leaking. Now the same thing was for this, we should actually always do preoperative ultrasounds, which will tell us whether this patient has hypermobile urethrovesical angle as well as cystocele. If I have that one of the pictures, I'll just show. Is this closed?
You have to share your screen first.
Share screen.
Yeah, I'm trying to share screen. Can you see this picture now?
Yes.
Here, this is the pubic symphysis. Okay?
Yeah.
And here you have the actual angle. But when the patient cuffs and Valsalva manual there, you can see this ischiosis has gone beyond.
Correct.
Okay. Now, if this patient, here again, you can see typically, this is called like a bird's head. Can you see this cystocele and this is the beak like thing here? So this is the cystocele has gone out as well as the urethral angle is down. So when you just correct the cystocele, the urethra is also down and that's why these patients leak. So we correct only the cystocele. Now, so preoperatively, if we do these recordings, then we are aware sometimes a patient with cystocele, large cystocele is masking a rectocele. So as soon as you correct her cystocele, she will come with another prolapse, that is rectocele, which was already there for her. But it was getting masked because of a huge cystocele. Now, when we are doing sacrocolpopexy, when we are pulling the vagina back to the sacral promontory, we are actually opening the anterior compartment. And these patients, that's why have stress incontinence, that is the one of the complication of sacrocolpopexy or sacrohistropexy is SUI. But there we are not supposed to do concomitant sling procedures. You first do, there you have to explain the patient that right now we are just going to do posterior compartment repair. If at all you have SUI, then we will correct it. Otherwise, if you do it beforehand, there is a chance that she will not be able to pass urine.
Retention is a major problem.
Yes.
Sandesh, is this a normal sonography or a special sonography? Because
this is regular sonography with our regular linear probe kept on perineum.
Dr. Aparna Hegde promotes something called a 3D sonography for all these repairs. I don't know.
3D sonography is not required. Regular linear probe or the superficial probe gives the best ones, which we use for thyroid and all this.
And you were mentioning about the posterior UV angle, but in the pathology now for the stress incontinence, the posterior UV angle has lost its importance. That is why all the STEMI Pereira surgeries have all gone.
Yeah.
Now they say the problem is shifted to the mid urethra. They give the analogy of a weak floor. And they see as a hose pipe is kept on a hard ground and you press on it, it will stop the leak. But if it is kept on a sand, it will not stop the leak. So how is the posterior UV angle still relevant in the description which you mentioned?
His point was the occult SUI, which, you know, goes, if what he showed was a big cystocele coming
in. Yeah, that I understood. And that mass thing. Yeah.
That is what he was saying.
No. Okay, anyway. We'll talk take the discussion later on during the question answers.
No, yeah. I did not get. Okay, we'll go.
What you mentioned was the posterior UV angle gets corrected when the there was originally a SUI, the prolapse masked it because the angle got kinked, right?
Yes. Yes.
And when we restored that, we corrected the prolapse by a Lafort's or a abdominal sacral colpopexy. We made the bladder back to its anatomical position. And the angle which was there got restored.
Yes.
And the leakage started.
Angle of the bladder only got restored. The urethrovesical angle is all at fault.
So that is no more at fault according to the latest studies, right? They say the posterior UV angle was because the surgeries which we learned when our residency, STEMI Pereiras and all, they used to restore that posterior UV angle. We used to take the stitch and RAS repair or STEMI Pereiras repair. So they used to pull that posterior UV angle. And we used to see through a cystoscope, the closure of a flower, where we used to see the posterior UV angle open and it was used to get closed. Then the era came where this was no more a defect, no more the problem, and the problem was in the mid urethra.
See,
and that is why the mid urethral slings came. They never restored the angle.
See, if you have this.
So you are right, Samir. So all these surgeries or treatment modalities have evolved around a theory of SUI, which that particular person who's developing the surgery accepts.
Yeah, particular.
So now, because see, if you accept urethral hypermobility as a theory and differential pressure transmission as a theory, then your laparoscopic birch works on very well.
Right.
If you accept the theory that there is a mid urethral level problem, then those mid urethral slings work very well.
No, but what should we accept as a general gynecologist? This theory is only good for me. But what should I tell the patient?
So now what I fathom is you are left with that's why I said the statement. If you see American Urology Association, we are now left with probably other than some medicines only three basic procedures. Yeah. Either your mid urethral procedures like TOT, TVT.
Yeah.
Or birch.
In fact, TOT is also out now. TOT is more or less out.
I know. So, or birch, or you put bulking agents inside the sphincter. So, we are basically left with only these options which we are giving to our patients.
Perfect. Yeah. And the take home point is you should not, by and large, combine this with a prolapse surgery.
Yeah.
Let the fibrosis occur, and if it comes again, then we can do it.
So thank you, Dr. Samir sir, for such an elaborative lecture. And now we are reaching up to the end, but there is lots of debate of the sacropathy, pectopathy, and use of the mesh and non-use of the mesh.
Okay, and I will, for the discussion fact, I will like to invite Dr. Sandesh Kare to this forum of the discussion. He is a director of Sunrise Hospital, Solapur. He is visiting consultant to Nigeria and Abu Dhabi. And he is the most wanted surgeon nowadays in all the workshops because of his clear concepts and the clear-cut explanations. Welcome, Dr. Sandesh.
Yeah.
And now...
Sandesh, you are most wanted.
Thank you so much.
You are most wanted.
Wanted, but now we cannot travel. That's the problem.
आपका नेटिव टिश्यू वाला वीडियो जरूर दिखाइएगा.
ओके,
जबरदस्त वीडियो है.
मोस्ट ऑफ द नेटिव टिश्यू रिपेयर समीर हैज शोन इट एक्सीलेंट, एंड आई टू बिलीव दैट वेर एवर पॉसिबल वजाइनल सर्जरी शुड बी द फर्स्ट सर्जरी. सो स्पेशली ही मेंशन्ड वन थिंग दैट द वजाइनल एक्सिस इज एक्चुअली कंट्रोल्ड बाय द यूट्रोसैक्रल लिगामेंट्स. ओके, so one thing I would like to share here is that procedure, all the debate, all the complications, and always one another, the sacropexy people or the pectopexy people, all are fighting about the angle. So the best angle is given by the uterosacral ligament. So what we should do in cases for native tissue repair is to do a good high uterosacral ligament suspension. Now, I think very, very few people in India can do it vaginally. And most of them are not doing it because it is very complicated and very high incidence of ureteric injuries or kinking of the ureter or ligating both the ureters. So that is the biggest problem. So we feel that the best uterosacral ligament suspension can be done by laparoscopy, where you take care of these ureters as well as the nerves. Yesterday I showed in my presentation in Neuropelviology, high uterosacral ligament suspension or McCall's scoldoplasty, these are associated with involvement of the S234 nerves, the hypogastric nerves and the pelvic splanchnic nerves. So I will just share my video on this. So here I have this video of high uterosacral ligament suspension by laparoscopy, where we first do uretrolysis, then we identify the right and the left hypogastric nerve, and then we, depending upon how much high ligation we want to do.
We can't see the video still.
No, I'm playing it now. Do you have it now?
Yes.
So the first step is to do a good ureterolysis. So this is on the right side. I am doing the ureterolysis. You can appreciate the peristalsis of the ureter. Next is to do a ureterolysis with hypogastric nerve preservation. So on left side now, we are going to do, that is the uterosacral ligament, and the peritoneum here is being cut lateral to the uterosacral ligament to identify the ureter. So this is the identification of the ureter. We are maintaining the adventitia of the ureter. And now see how I pull the fat which is under the ureter. This fat and the lower part in 1.5 centimeters below it, it will contain the hypogastric nerve. So you don't need to see it, but on some, now here you can see this white structures. This is the hypogastric nerve. So now once you do a hysterectomy, this is a case of laparoscopic hysterectomy where we thought that this patient will need to have a good apical support. Otherwise, very soon she will land up with a prolapse. So all our hysterectomies, whether they are for DUB or fibroids or for anything, we always try to see if there is already a weak cervical ring, because our surgery hysterectomy is going to weaken it more. So unless we correct in our basic hysterectomy, just doing wall suspension and fixing the angle of the uterosacral is not enough in these cases. We might have to do the apical repair properly, where the cervix has two apical supports. The level one of Delancey has uterosacrals and the cardinal ligaments. So both this fixation has to be there. Now here I am closing the vault. This is the anteroposterior angle of the vault, and this is the routine what we do is fixing the uterosacral to the vault. So this is on the right side, and then we go to complete the vault. This is again through the fresh edges of the vagina, very thick bites are taken. And then on the last is the left side, uterosacral is fixed. But this itself is not enough. So we have to do high uterosacral ligament suspension. So we pull on the uterosacral and appreciate how much we have to go high up. And from here, I am going down into the uterosacral. Now I am not afraid because I have separated both the ureter as well as the nerve. So I am going down to the vault. And then I pass my suture through the vault and again come up. So that this is exactly like how we are doing round ligament plications. So again on the left side, I'm going down towards the vault, no fear of the ureter, no fear of the nerves, and then proper fixation of the uterosacral to the vault, and then come back again. Can be done with proline also. And this is how we fix the high uterosacral to the vault. So, this gives the best support as well as the access, and it is bilateral and safe because of the laparoscopic approach. Now one more native tissue repair which we do is for cystocils, the central cystocils. See, the whole problem of repairs is the most difficulty to repair the anterior compartment. We have read in the literature that anterior compartment is the most difficult to treat, and that is because we consider all cystocils as cystocele. We don't try to differentiate, or we don't try to find the cause of the cystocele. What we treat is bulge. We don't treat the pathology. The biggest pathology is the non-identification of the apical prolapse, which gives rise to a cystocele. So what we push inside is just the bulge. We don't take care of the apical prolapse. And apical prolapse, I mean on the anterior part, is the cardinal ligament or the bladder. So here I'm going to show you the apical correction of the bladder cystocele in the central part. So post vault repair, see now this vault is corrected. Here you have the defect here as well. So what we do is again, we pass sutures depending upon the amount of defect. We pass two layers, three layers of the sutures. If you are using a sponge on forceps, sponge forceps there with a gauze piece, pull it out first. Best is to use some manipulator or the speculum so that you can actually appreciate when you are passing the stitches that they are not going through and through the vagina. So this is the next layer of suturing. Very often we do this in vault prolapse also. We do this buttressing stitches to reduce the dimension width of the vagina. And then your requirement, if at all you really require to give a synthetic support to this repair, then at least by doing this, one is you are reducing the, you are increasing the thickness of the vagina. You are reducing the surface and so the mesh load in all is reduced by doing this buttressing stitches. So this is how you repair for the apical areas. And now last video I will share is on the lateral cystocele, which was actually very nicely shown by Manish. So here is the repair for the lateral cystocele. In the lateral cystocele, one has to understand the lateral cystocele is the level 2 defect. The level 1 defect is the cervical ring, which is by uterosacral or cardinal ligament. Second level down, the support is from the white line, which is also called arcus tendinous fascia pelvis. So this white line is between the obturator internus, internal oblique muscle and the pelvic floor, the levator ani muscles. So thickening of this levator ani muscles is called as the white line, which was described by Dr. White, and it looks also white. So that line is the one which is supporting the lateral angle of the vagina. So our lateral cystocele, here we are in the space of Retzius, that is the pubic bone pectineal ligament identified. This part has to be cut to identify the urethra. Initially, a few cases, this is scary, but you can easily cut it and then you find the subpubic angle. And then you can actually identify the urethra and the vagina. So next step is to pull the bladder, that is the white line, if you can appreciate that, between the internal oblique and the levator ani muscles. So once we do that, then we do the identification of the paracolpus, that is the assistant puts a finger into the vaginal part lateral angle. We pull the bladder medially and we identify the vagina. Now, unlike Birch operation where you fix the paraurethral stitches to the pectineal ligament, in lateral repair of the vagina, you don't have to go high up to the pectineal ligament, because then you actually change the angle or you rotate the vagina. You should fix it to white line or at the most to the oblique muscles. So here you will see we are taking the stitch through the paracolpus. This is higher up than what Manish had shown in the Birch. And it has been shown, now here I am going through the muscle, if you appreciate. This is not coming high up to the pectineal ligament. And here you will actually appreciate it is not a hanging stitch, but it gets opposed. Same way we see it now, that is the white line is seen. The vaginal stitch is being taken. And then we pass it slightly higher above the white line and into the muscle. So this part also gets opposed. So on in very large procedentias, when the bulge is too much and the lateral defect is there, we prefer to put these stitches for a good vaginal length. So depending upon how much is the defect, we keep on going up to the ischial spine. The best way is actually to come from the ischial spine downwards. It has been shown that the cut or the injury or the defect at the ischial spine at that level leads to the lower down parapulpus defects. So thank you very much for allowing me to share my videos.
Sandesh,
yes,
I think you use Ethibond, no, for the
yes.
When I discussed with Dr. Amey also, the Ethibond it causes a lot of fibrosis, which is a good suture. So that fibrosis, yes, because of Ethibond also, yes, helps.
Yes.
So I have this, and this was also shown in the STAR conference by Professor Noye Gonter when he had come, I think 2 years back.
Yes.
He had shown all these native tissue repairs. And yes, that time I had asked him a question, ki, why not do all this from vagina?
Yes.
So he said the advantage of doing it laparoscopically was after vaginal surgeries, there is an increased risk of urge incontinence. So that part was not very clear. And whether we can, nowadays we use absorbable sutures. We have always been taught, in our residency, we use Catgut and now we use Vicryl for all the A repair and P repair. If we replace that by Ethibond, say 2-0 Ethibond, will our recurrence rates reduce according to the same logic?
If at all we are banking on fibrosis, then definitely this is going to create more fibrosis.
So then there will not be a problem of mesh erosion problems, and it will serve the same purpose.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Samir, yeah, the advantage, the little advantage of Ethibond is over, I have used initially proline. Proline has a lot of memory.
Yes.
Yeah, so yeah, suturing at times sometimes
becomes.
No,
I am not talking
difficult
about laparoscopy at all. I am trying to extrapolate the same concept to vaginal.
Vagina. Okay.
And reinforce that.
Ethibond is polyester. It's
polyester
material.
Non-absorbable.
So,
yeah.
Yeah, and it will induce a lot of
non-absorbable suture used vaginally will again follow the same history of a mesh which got eroded, and so that risk is going to be there.
Correct.
Somebody is posted in the chat, there is an ideal suture for repair is not Vicryl but PDS.
Ideal suture for?
P repair is PDS. Somebody is written in the chat box. What the comment for the PDUs of PDS? Because everybody is using
PDS. Yeah. PDS is more delayed absorbable. No, that is why. See, when Professor Shlomo Raz had come first time in India in 2004 for a urogynec conference, he had shown MRI pictures and he had said very clearly that they were trying to explain the prolapse comparing to hernia. So hernia, people always use mesh as a hernioplasty because they say that the native tissue has got weak. That is why the prolapse has occurred. And if you repair with the same native tissue, you're going to have a recurrence. So you have to have a soft proline mesh. Soft proline mesh meant that the pores were 60% and the mesh was 40%. So fibroblasts will grow through that mesh pores and it will reinforce the collagen and it will not cause recurrence. And then first he showed all this, and then Professor Ajay Rane came and he showed that apogee perigee. But then there were a lot of cases where in the third conference when they came, they were showing all the complications of mesh. And that is why the vaginal mesh got out. And then after that, suddenly there's a surge of laparoscopy mesh. So that is the whole history.
Yes, the issue also is
vaginally, when you are doing these prolapse surgeries, these patients are aged patients. So many of them are maybe menopausal, perimenopausal, where already they are low on estrogen. Yep. The vaginal thickness has already gone down. So all these add to the mesh problems which happen in, you know.
No. What was told by Professor Ajay Rane during this conference, I think, which was done by Dr. Trivedi, where Vyomesha did almost 30 vaginal hysterectomies in 3 hours. So in that conference, Ajay Rane had come and he said that thickness of the vaginal epithelium what we were traditionally taught as first posters, we used to keep the vagina, keep our finger behind to prevent the buttonhole while dissecting. And then we used to do the plication of the fascia. So he used to put all that fascia on the vagina. So the vagina has to be thick. And what he said is a mesh which is kept without tension on a viscera, that is a either a bladder anteriorly or a rectum posteriorly, cannot penetrate the viscera. In a TVT, what happens is, suppose you go through the bladder wall and don't do a cystoscopy, that time the mesh will erode the bladder wall and come in the bladder. But if it is just placed there and it comes out through those apogee, the perigees anteriorly and apogees posterior needles, it cannot penetrate. And since the vagina is already thick because of the fascia, it will not cause erosion. So that was his concept, but it now it is
the proper off. Plane. If we have to separate the fascia, both fascia with the fascia of the visceral fascia with the bladder.
Fascia has to be with the vagina. Even if somebody is doing a TVT or a TOT, when you do dissection, the vagina has to be thick. Otherwise, the mesh will erode. And the mesh should be never be under tension. So one has to, when you tighten in a TVT, one has to keep an artery forceps.
Yeah, or
it will cause a retention.
Whenever you open the skin or the mucosa and putting the mesh, then there is a high chances of infection and erosion actually. This is a complication in the sling surgeries where we are inserting the mesh through the skin port or we are putting the mesh through the vagina because we are opening the mucosa external opening actually and we are exposing the mesh to the external environment. In the sacroplexy or pectoplexy, we are putting the mesh directly into the abdominal cavity without having touching the mesh and with all the aseptic precautions. And so there is less chances of mesh erosion, and with the under endoscopic vision, we actually can separate and.
I don't think that is the cause, because whenever we are going to put mesh in any open surgery, also we normally change the gloves. We again put a fresh drape and we use all precautions.
Yeah.
So that all
there
is done.
We open na, open that means infection. You are going through the port and you are not opening the abdomen, not opening the skin, not opening the vagina.
Our OT, OT is fumigated, madam.
But I'm actually that I'm sharing my experience only.
What I want? Hello.
Yeah.
See, the patient selection has to be very, very good. Don't try to put mesh in a very old patient where the vagina is very thin and it has lost.
Sandesh, ek thing. Agar old patient, 85-year-old patient coming with the world prolapse, what we should
do? Lefort's corona, Lefort's.
Lefort is the correct simple person. In local also, we've done.
Any first poster can do.
I have done Lefort's under local anesthesia.
For the mucus, this Lefort.
Lefort's mein infiltrate karo, vagina nikalo aur suture karo, ho gaya.
But if patient is not ready to obliterate the vagina, then
sacrospinous fixation do.
85 years old.
Do a good sacrospinous fixation.
Sacrospinous fixation can be done, but in such an old patient, ischial spine cannot be palpated only. It's so it has become all.
Sandesh sir.
Yes.
Hello, Sandesh sir. Yeah.
Yes.
Hello.
Yeah, I
yes,
can
sir,
hear
I
you.
I can hear you.
Nahata sir, I can hear you.
Sandesh sir, can I ask you? Hello. Sir, you are all these your prolapse experts, you are talking about the vaginal angle. What will happen if there is a vaginal angle changes during the pectopexy or like that? What are the problems? Will they have problem in physical relations? Will they have problem in urination? What is the problem?
See, normally the levator plate is there, levator plate, which is at the lowermost part. On that, the vagina is lying horizontal. So when the intra-abdominal pressure rises, the vagina is closing anteroposteriorly because the angle is something like this. In the lower part, it is slightly vertical and then it is horizontal. So with pressure, it closes anteroposteriorly. When this levator plate detaches, the pressure will start, it becomes more vertical. The vagina becomes vertical. So the pressure will actually allow the prolapse to happen. So the axis of vagina is preventing prolapse. By changing the axis or because of change in the axis, the prolapse has happened. So if we are changing the axis, then we are actually making it more prone. Now in pectopexy, even though it is in the same level, the vagina becomes vertical. So again, it is prone for prolapse.
Sandesh, can you explain about the descending perineal syndrome? This is something which new, which we are hearing, and even Dr. Ramesh mentioned about it. So what is it, how it is different from prolapse? Like, what is descending perineal syndrome?
No, it is prolapse only. The whole perineum, actually the everything descends in that case. And mainly what we feel, see in our cases is rectocele. But in that case, there can be a case of rectal prolapse also. Yeah. Inversion of the mucosa is also there. Constipation is there. So in those cases, the whole of the endopelvic fascia is lost. So all the organs with raised, if you do a MRI, defecogram, you will actually appreciate with the Valsalva, the whole pelvis moves outside.
So a rectal prolapse, that the mucosa of the rectum prolapses to the rectum also is essential, yes, part of descending perineal syndrome, right?
Yes, in that case, yes. Yeah. So in descending perineal syndrome, we usually prefer to put the mesh into the, if I can show, if we have time, of course.
Yeah, we have time. Sushila, sorry, meri question puchne ki aadat nahi jayegi online webinars mein.
Jitne log baithe hain bas wo sunne ke liye baithe hain. Ab aap time is yours, no speakers
behind. See, in the rectal prolapse, rectocele, we put the mesh between the vagina and the rectum. So here you can see the mesh has actually gone. Now we are going into the right puborectalis muscle. This levator ani is not one muscle. These are three pairs of muscle. One which come from the pubic bone, the iliac bone, and the ischium. So puborectalis, iliococcygeus, and ischiococcygeus. So this pubo part has two parts, puborectalis and pubovaginalis. So the puborectalis muscle, which is the most medial muscle, actually has twitch fibers. So the mesh has to attach to this so that the perineum gets pulled up when there is intra-abdominal
video
pressure.
Is not playing.
So now the needle is going through the puborectalis part of the muscle. See if you can appreciate the yellow fat there, rectum, which is very close. And good thick bite is taken, and then the Y arm is attached to on that side. So here you will see the mesh is being placed between the vagina and the rectum to prevent the rectum bulging into the vagina. That is the rectocele. This is on the right side of the patient. Same way we go to the left side. Here again I am passing the needle from the suprapubic port. See, the good thick bite is taken. We always fix the mesh first and then bring and fix the tissues over it, whether it is walled prolapse or hysterouterus is being hysteropexy or whatever. First create a platform, that is a scaffold, and then you pull the vault and fix it to the mesh. Don't fix it to the vagina and pull it up. So because of this, when you first create a tension free platform or framework, then you can actually decide how much you want to pull the tissues and place it over this, and then a number of points of fixation. So usually this is like a 6-point fixation. So this is for a rectocele or regular prolapses which we see. And I'm sure if we have, yeah, and now in this case descending perineum, where the rectum is actually going out more, and this is slightly beyond the you will see actually the ischial fossa, ischiorectal fossa also bulge in these patients. So here we are putting the mesh behind the rectum. So this is the left arm of the mesh. You are seeing only the left Y arm. Here she is not suffering from rectocele. The rectum is not bulging into her vagina. It is the rectum and the whole of the pelvis is going down. So here, see, this is one left arm and now this is the right arm of the mesh. It is actually, we have created a hollow under the rectum or the sigmoid. And then we place the Y arm posterior to this. So this is the right side of the mesh, which is being placed to the levator ani muscles. and then the vertical arm is fixed to the sacral promontory, and later on we pull the rectum up and then we fix it to the mesh. And if this fails, then if the prolapse is too much, then what you have to do is do a sigmoid resection and remove that part if it's a very huge prolapse.
I think all the queries now cleared, and we come to at the end of the session. I don't think any query left behind in the chat box also, and anywhere, and everything is covered well, and everybody is asking about the recordings only. So we will provide the recordings, and we will send the certificate of the credit points also. We accredited 7 ICOG credit point and 4 Rajasthan Medical Council points for this webinar. And thanks to the all the speakers who make successful this event very academic and formative and worthwhile for all of us. And we learned a lot from all of you, the delegated speakers. So thank you so much, everybody, to join us and being with us since last 2 days. We are sitting on the one sofa and attending the webinar. So now I request Dr. Vijayanatha sir, before we concluding our Rajendogyni, we want to listen something from you, because there is no banquet in this webinar and this corona actually make us very much dry, and now we are just looking for some party.
Are you ready? आप झेलने के लिए तैयार हैं?
हम तो सर तैयार हैं कोरोना की ऐसी.
चलिए तो आपकी पसंद का गाना सुना देते हैं.
So actually webinar is over now, banquet has started.
मेनू भी बता देना, चल रहा था मेनू, और हम लोग घर पे बना के खाएंगे.
उसमें जाइए आपका होस्ट वाले में.
हेलो डॉक्टर
देश दीपक, कॉन्ग्रेट्स, सुपर इवेंट, नाइस.
सबको अनम्यूट कर दिया मैंने, अनम्यूट ऑल.
बहुत किचकिच हो जाएगा. आई थिंक वी शुड अलाउ द रेज हैंड एंड देन अनम्यूट दैट. स्टार्ट.
पसंद का सुना रहे हैं.
Yes, sir.
बैंकेट को न्यूरो वैसे तो पार्टी होती है ना इस सेमिनार में, हम रात में जाते हैं.
पल पल दिल के पास तुम रहती हो,
आवाज नहीं आ रही है.
आ रही है?
आ रही सर.
हर शाम आंखों पर तेरा चल लहराए, हर रात यादों की बारात ले आए. मैं सांस लेता हूँ तेरी खुशबू आती है, एक महका महका सा पैगाम लाती है. मेरे मेरे दिल की धड़कन भी तेरे गीत गाती है. पल पल दिल के पास तुम रहती हो.
Thank you.
Far away from singing. I'm Kansen.
MSET is what? What is MSET, sir?
Ondensetron. For
okay.
So anybody wants to sing or say something, to platform is open, just raise the hand. Raise the hand. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, suna rahi hai na.
कहाँ खत्म बड़ी ये मंजिले है कौन सी ना इस ना हम समझ सके ना तुम अजीब दास्तां है ये कहाँ शुरू कहाँ खत्म ये मंजिले है कौन सी ना वो समझ सके हम मुबारके के तुम किस नीत हो गए किसी के इतने पास हो के सबसे टूट गए
Oh, ma'am. Superb, ma'am. Superb. Thank you. Dr. Suman also say something. Suman Chaurasia? Do you want to sing? Dr. Suman Chaurasia?
No. I just want to thank everyone. It was a wonderful session and I'm really thankful to all the teachers and madam to you. That you have conducted such a nice conference and I'm really thankful. Thank you everyone. Thank you all the teachers. Happy Teachers Day. And please let me know whenever the conference is there. Thank you so much.
So I don't think anybody else is, wants to sing. And
hello, we take your leave. Thank you so much.
Thank you
all.
Congratulations. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you. Congrats, Sushila. So, thank you so much.
Thank you everyone for joining us and being with us. Thank you so much.
Well done.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, bye.